beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is.
just lift your hands to him and start singing your own song to him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we just thank you so much today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the power and authority, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Oh, we thank you, Father. This next song we're going to sing, every time we sing it, I always have someone who comes into mind. And so I want to urge you this morning that while we're singing this next song, if you have someone come to your mind that needs prayer, that needs lifted up, that needs the truth, I want you to be interceding and I want you to be praying for them. If it's someone in this congregation that you know needs prayer, please feel free to go over and lay hands on them and start praying for them while we sing this song. Thank you, Jesus.
I hear the voice of one crying. I hear the voice of one crying. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make his path straight. Make straight his path in the wilderness. Let his light shine. Let his light shine in the dark. Let your rain fall. Let your rain fall in this desert. I hear the voice of one crying. I hear the voice of one crying. Prepare ye the way of the Lord.
The shore is gold, is precious, and the honey sweet. So you love this. Distance, like a train on the edge of the town.
thunder in the distance, like a train on the edge of the town. I can feel the brooding of your spirit. Lay your burdens down. Lay your burdens down.
Revival with your fire.
sins of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sore, so we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, flooding on the clouds, shining like the sun.
Jehovah, there's no God like 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 Jehovah. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, and the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, and the trumpet call, lift your voice.
We put everything aside that's distracting us. We lay it at your feet. We focus on you and what you've done for us. Thank you, Jesus.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've made it, when it's all about you.
this song isn't on the list, but the Lord wants me to sing this. Band, I'm sorry. But if you can play, we're going to be in the key of C. Okay.
His gates. Oh,
you are, you're in front of God right now. And when we sing this, I want you to sing it to Him.
You truly are my King, and I will serve your throne to worship you alone. You truly are my King, and I will serve your throne to worship you alone. You truly are my King, serve your throne to worship you alone. You truly are my King, and I will serve your throne to worship you alone. Oh, how I love you. Just tell Him. Oh, how I love you. Oh, how I love you. I will give my life to you. I will give my life to you. We will give our lives to you.
Whenever you start worshiping, you instantly get into the throne room of God. Every time. Every single time. That's where we are right now. He is here. He's ready to love on you. All you have to do is open up and accept it.
Jesus, we worship you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. This is for someone that's here today, but I think it's for more than just one person. My child, I'd say to you that what you have believed about yourself is a lie. For you've tried to cover it up, and you put on a good show, but deep down on the inside that you believe you're not worthy of my love. And what you've done is too far, too deep for me to touch you. You've thought that, yes, that's for everyone else, but it's not for me because I'm too bad on the inside. And I would tell you this day that you are not. That my love is upon you, and I would tell you that those things that you think that are so bad have already been forgiven. For I died for you, my child. You thought that you have fallen too far down, that you'd never be used again, you'd be tossed out like garbage. And those are the things you've pondered in your heart, and I would tell you this day that that is not true. For my love is upon you, and I care for you, and I will raise you up. And I want you this day to begin to declare that you are loved of me. And you will begin to lift your eyes towards me. For those things that you think are so bad, I have forgiven. And they have been cast aside, and I no longer even see them. For I look at my child as one that I greatly love, and I desire to draw you near. So I would say this day to cast that aside in your own heart and allow me to love you and to care for you. For I'll raise you up, for I have a plan and a place for you, saith the Lord, and I will bring you up high. And you shall no longer be in that place of pain and anguish, but you shall know that I have delivered you and set you free. For my love is upon you, my child. So begin to raise your hands and begin to declare and thank me that I am your Lord and I love you. And there's nothing, nothing, nothing that can separate you from my love, saith the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We praise you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We worship you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. There's a scripture that says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. And I always want to go so. But let's say, let the redeemed of the Lord say so.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So say, I am redeemed.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Father.
Praise you, Father. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Well, turn to your neighbor and say, you are redeemed and I am redeemed. Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Well, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to 2 Timothy 1:7. 2 Timothy 1:7. You know, one of my favorite preachers, Norval Hayes, he used to say this. He said, you know, God can't bless stingy Christians and lazy Christians. And, you know, that's true. And for the most part, I believe most Christians aren't stingy and they're not lazy. But I think the thing that robs us of all our blessings, because, you know, the Bible says that God has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. The Bible says that Jesus Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, that the blessings of Abraham might come on us through Christ Jesus. So, man, what great promises. The blessings of Abraham is, you know, you're blessed coming in, you're blessed going out, you're blessed in the city, you're blessed in the field. He'll command his blessing upon your storehouses and down upon all that you set your hand unto. He'll bless your basket and your store. All the people of the earth will see that you're called by the name of the Lord and they should be afraid of you. He'll open up his good treasure and pour out his good treasure upon you. And you'll have so much money that you'll lend and not borrow. And, you know, lend to the nations, the whole nine yards. I mean, great, great promises, you know. And then another blessing of Abraham's in Genesis 13, because Abraham, it said he was very rich in cattle and silver and gold. You know, and that's ours, because we inherit the blessings of Abraham. So we can make that confession that I'm rich in cattle, silver, and gold. And then it says in Genesis 12, you know, that I'll bless you, make your name great, and you'll be a blessing to the world. You know, that's why God wants to bless us, so we'll be a blessing. Amen. And so all these blessings are ours, and, you know, the Bible over and over again talks about God always causes us to triumph in Christ Jesus. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. On and on and on it goes. But yet, Most of us Christians don't operate in the victory that we should. In Romans 10, when it says that with the heart man believes unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is made unto salvation, that word salvation doesn't mean just being saved from hell. That word salvation means, you know, protection, deliverance, prosperity, blessings, the whole nine yards. And so why aren't we walking more in victory? Well, I don't think it's the stinginess or the laziness or anything like that. I think it's because of fear. And the reason why I say that is because just recently I saw a definition of the word fear in the Greek. And I'm going to read that and kind of preach on that today. But, of course, 2 Timothy 1:7 says, God has not given us a spirit of fear or timidity, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And the definition for fear in the Greek is timidity or intimidation or cowardice. It means to intimidate means to inspire with fear. You know, we're not to be inspired by fear, but we're to be inspired by faith. Amen. It means to be overawed. You know, you become awed not with God, but you become awed with evil. You become awed with what the devil and what he's doing. You become awed with sickness, to restrain from action by a strong sense of inferiority, to cow down, to retreat with submission. When we submit to intimidation, we lose the victory, and then we can't be used of God. We lose our place of authority when we give in to that fear and intimidation. And it just seems like human nature is just kind of attracted to the negative. I mean, kind of an example of that, you know, it says to be overawed with evil. You know, the other day I was at the farm show talking to one of my friends and saying, telling them a story. I think I've already told this story here. But I was at the Metrolink station in a bad neighborhood witnessing a ministering one night. And this guy came along, and I mean, he was so demon-possessed. He just, you know, just like in the gospel, the man from Gadaris, he was just, he went and grabbed the trash in the trash can and just started throwing the trash out. Then he grabbed the bag out of the trash bag, and then he started throwing the sandwiches in that dirty trash bag. And I said, you can only have one sandwich. And he said, no, I can have as many as I want. I said, no, you can only have one sandwich. And he says, I can have as many as I want. And I said, in Jesus' name, devil, I bind you. Get out of here. In Jesus' name, I take authority over you. Get out of here. And he says, there is no Jesus, just Allah. And I said, get out of here in Jesus' name. And finally he left. And that's the good news. Bad news is he came back with a razor. So he walks back and forth looking at me with murder in his eyes. And he says, I'm going to kill you. I'm going to kill you. And he says, if I have to, I'll go to the dream center and kill you, but I'm going to kill you. And he had this razor back and forth, and I was praying, binding, you know, the whole nine yards. And then finally he made his move. He put the razor in the air and grabbed the bucket, or we had a pail of sandwiches, and he grabbed it and started throwing those in his trash bag. And I didn't want to give up that place of authority, you know, that I was talking about, because when we give in to intimidation and fear, we lose our place of authority. And I didn't want to lose that place of authority. So I said, devil, because, you know, they're just old sandwiches. You know, I'm not trying to lose my life over old sandwiches. I mean, you know, old lettuce and, you know, the whole nine yards. So that's not the issue. The issue is my place of authority. So I said, I take authority over you, devil, in Jesus' name. You get out of here in Jesus' name. And all of a sudden, there's this big black guy standing next to me. And I don't know where he came from or who he was or if he's an angel, you know, or what. But that big black guy said, you leave these people alone. And he left us alone. And praise God. So anyway, I told a friend this, you know, and instead of being awed by what God did and the deliverance that he gave us, he was awed by what the devil did and said, man, I was going to start going out with you on the streets of St. Louis, but I'm not going to now. And, it, you know, that just kind of shows you how people, you know, they're awed by the devil. They're awed by evil. But what about being awed by what God did? He delivered me. He saved me, praise God. Amen. I mean, just like this one pastor at the Dream Center, he's a real man of faith, and he was on his deathbed, and God healed him. He had a deadly terminal disease, but he stood on the word, and God healed him. And so one day he went to the hospital and prayed for someone else who was on their deathbed. And he said that after he prayed for him, he said they started planning for their funeral. And, you know, that's not faith. I mean, you know, that's not faith. kind of obvious. But But you know, they were so awed by that sickness and that disease, instead of being awed by this great man of faith and power for God's very hour. You know, he prayed the prayer of faith just like the Bible says. But yet, instead of being awed by that, you know, praying the prayer of faith, he was awed by that sickness and started planning his funeral right afterwards. And I know last year we were at the convention in Branson, and we broke off into groups. And this one man, he said, well, I've been diagnosed with a certain disease. And he says, so I'm just going to, you know, just live the rest of my life with this disease. I'm just planning my retirement and my old age just to live with this disease. And it didn't even cross his mind to resist that disease, that we've been redeemed from that disease, that by his stripes he's healed of that disease, that Jesus took his infirmities and bore his sicknesses. What he did was, instead of being awed by his stripes we're healed, instead of being awed by the fact that Jesus redeemed us from sickness, disease, death, poverty, lack, failure, from all the curse of the law, that I'll live and not die and declare the works of the Lord, that with long life he'll satisfy me and show me his salvation. Instead of being awed by that, he was awed by the sickness and by the disease, and he just completely gave into it and said, I'm planning the rest of my life to live with this. And what you're doing when you do that is you're giving up your place of authority. Amen. And it's the same thing with witnessing to share Christ. You know, I work out at a gym there at where I live, and there's guys in there. It's just, you know, I can see why, you know, they invented Planet Fitness. When I go to Washington, D.C. to visit Jeff Wright, who is from this church and everything, you know, has a ministry, National Prayer Embassy in Washington, D.C. When I go to visit him, he goes to Planet Fitness. So I go to Planet Fitness. That's where you can't sweat. You can't make noise. You can't, you can't drop the weights, you know. If they do, they call it the clunk machine will ring, you know. And you can't make that clunk machine go off, you know, you're kicked out, you know. But I can see the wisdom because, you know, my gym is just like the other side of the coin. People cursing, cussing, talking dirty, and, you know. And you know, when I grew up here, I was an honorary person, but I at least respected elders and older people and didn't curse around them and so on, or tried not to, you know. And yet these guys are cursing and cussing. Well, many times what I'll do is, and just the other day, some guys were sitting on a couch where they got a TV and sitting on the couch just cursing and cursing, F this, F that. And finally, I said, look, if they're bold enough to sit there and curse like this, then I should be bold enough to go over there and tell them about Jesus. And, you know, these are obviously tough guys and stuff because they're, you know, they're lifting weights, and these guys, you know, they're in their, you know, boxing and stuff like that. But, you know, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Amen. And so I went over there and just started telling them about Jesus. And the way I look at it is, if I'm intimidated by them, and if I am fearful of them and the devil's in them, then I've given up my place of authority. And then the devil can just do whatever he wants to. Just like the saying that evil will prevail if good men say nothing. Well, there's truth in that. Amen. If we don't take our place of authority and realize that greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world, I'm not going to cow down, you know, to these guys. And I mean, this all the time I get in situations where, you know, where I come across guys like that. I go out and run at a high school near where we live. And it's, you know, it's not super close to us, but it's a kind of an affluent high school. And so these are rich kids. Now, and they go to the inner city and witness, they're receptive. They're very receptive. But you go farther out, you go from St. Louis, you know, the proper St. Louis and the inner city, the harder it gets to witness, believe it or not. Even though the inner city is considered, is voted the most dangerous zip code in the nation, and gunshots constantly and the whole nine yards. And but it's actually easy to witness there, and because they're receptive. But you go out to where, you know, the farther you get out, the harder it gets to witness. And so I'm at this rich high school. And you run around the track, and I come across guys all the time. Just the other day, there was three guys out there running late at night, and the devil's trying to get me intimidated, saying, you know, it's late at night. These guys could jump you and take your keys and take your car that's sitting right up there, and you don't know who they are. And, you know, lies, lies, lies. Amen. And so I began to share Christ with them and witness to them. And I mean, man, the light came on inside them, and you could just tell that they were like, wow, this sounds good. This sounds, you know, real. And they prayed to receive Jesus right there. And, you know, when we were in Kansas City, we had thousands of FFA kids coming into our booth from all over Kansas, Missouri, thousands come to our booth to get a walking stick. God just puts it on people's heart. They want a walking stick just for that moment because I hear it over and over again. Oh, I got one of those walking sticks. I threw it in my closet. Or I got it, you know, they throw it away, throw it in their truck, whatever. But for that moment, God puts it on their heart to want a walking stick so they can hear the gospel. So we got all these kids coming in, and we got a letter from one of the parents. And she said, you know, you prayed with my son to receive Jesus. One of the guys did. I'm not sure who. But she said, ever since you ministered to them, we poured in, not just salvation, but we just pour into them, getting into the word and how to live the Christian life. And she said, ever since he's been to that Kansas City Farm Show, he's been on fire for God. Amen. And sometimes we think we get overawed by the evil and by the sin nature of man, thinking, oh, they don't want to hear it. And, you know, if you tell them, they're just going to, you know, they're not going to receive. But, you know, we're giving them words of life, spirit and life. The word of God is alive, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. It's the only answer. Amen. I believe 12 years ago, I had an angel appear to me at the Louisville National FFA Convention in Louisville, Kentucky. We had been ministering for several days, and the leaders within our group were thinking about quitting for different reasons, and no one said anything outside our circle. This guy comes at 5 o'clock Friday afternoon, time to go home back to St. Louis. I was about ready to get my car and go, and this guy comes up and sits right in front of me with a British accent, and he says, whatever you do, don't quit. He says, you have the only answer, the only hope for these kids, and these are the future leaders of tomorrow. He said, whatever you do, don't quit. You have the answer, and you're giving them the answer. Don't quit. And I said, well, turn around and tell Dennis Slagle that, our CEO. So he turned around and told Dennis. Dennis said, that's an angel. He said exactly what God had already been dealing with me about. That was confirmation. Amen. And we got to realize that we have the only answer, the only hope. Amen. And not be overawed by the evil that's out there, by the cursing and the cussing and the drugs and the alcohol and the gangs. Amen. But we have, amen, words of life, the only answer, the only hope. And that's what we need to be awed by. Being intimidated means that you restrain from action by a strong sense of inferiority. In other words, you don't think this word works. You think that evil's greater than this, when just the opposite's true. You know, the devil's just a little imp and a wimp. Like Reinhard Bonnke says, he's a mouse with a microphone. You know? Kenneth Hagin, if you ever read his books, I Believe in Visions, Kenneth Hagin talks about how when he's had visions of little demons, and he talked about one time he said that he was talking to Jesus, and all of a sudden this little demon appeared like a little monkey, started going, yep, 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 yep. And he kept thinking, why doesn't Jesus tell this thing to get out of here? And long story short, finally Jesus said, I'm not going to tell it to get out of here. You've been given the authority to do it. You do it. So he said, in Jesus' name, get out of here. And that little demon took off running. But a lot of times we get overawed by the devil and think he's such a big bad dude, when really he's just like a little imp, little monkey. Like Smith Wigglesworth's wife, the devil appeared to her at the end of her bed. She lit a candle and looked and saw it was the devil. She said, oh, it's only you, and went back to bed. That needs to be our attitude. We shouldn't be awed by the devil and all his evil. Amen? Praise God. Praise God. Well, let me get to some scriptures. I like, while you're turning to, Numbers 14. In Joyce Myers' Battlefield of the Mind Bible, I saw this and I wrote it down. And her definition of fear is you take the F and it means false. Take the E, it means evidence. Take the A, it means appearing. And take the R, it means real. So it's false evidence appearing real. False evidence appearing real. And doesn't that describe the devil? You know, he makes it look like you're going to die. He makes it look like you're going to, you know, not survive and not get the victory. And if you believe his deceptions, then you've lost. And if you give in to his intimidation and cow down and overawed by his lies, then you lose. And that's why it's so important to get full of the word of God, because the word of God will dispel all his lies. Amen. Amen. That's why Jesus said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, then you'll ask what you will, then it shall be done unto you. You got to get God's word in you, because faith begins where the will of God is known. Bible says, my people perish for lack of knowledge. A lack of knowledge of the word. My people, God's people, perish for a lack of knowledge. Not the sinners, but God's people perish for a lack of knowledge of what's in the word of God. Amen. So we got to get God's word in our heart. Amen. But in Numbers chapter 14, maybe I'll start listening to my wife and get rid of so much clutter. Be easier to preach. But in Numbers 14, verse 3, it says, why is the Lord bringing us to this land of Canaan to fall by the sword? So right away we see they're overawed by the enemy, by the evil, by the people in Canaan. Our wives and our children will become plunder. Would it not be better for us to return to Egypt? A lot of people think, wouldn't it be better, you know, to not have to live by faith and just go live in a comfort zone and go live where it's comfortable and turn to natural means for help and guidance and protection? You know, I work security at Joyce Meyer Ministries, and they tell us in the security classes, they said, there's no 100% guarantee, no matter what kind of weapons you have, there's no 100% guarantee. And there is one guarantee, and that's Jesus and the Word of God. God always keeps his covenant of protection, always. Amen. It's not hit and miss. It's not hit and miss. It's not, well, one day he's in the mood to protect you, the next day he's not in the mood to protect you. One day he's in the mood to heal you, the next day he's not in the mood to heal you. It works every time. Amen. If you believe, praise God, and not are overawed by the devil and all everything out there. Amen. Don't cow down. Don't be intimidated. Praise God. But they said it would be better for us to return to Egypt. So they said to one another, let us appoint a new leader and return to Egypt. Then Moses and Aaron fell on their faces before all the assembly of the congregation of the Israelites. Joshua, the son of Nun, and Caleb, the son of another mother from another brother. As well, I'll do the message translation on that one. Who were among those who had spied out the land, tore their clothes as a sign of grief. And they spoke to all the congregation of the sons of Israel, saying, the land through which we passed as spies is an exceedingly good land. So God has exceedingly good and precious promises for us. Amen. It's not junk, it's good stuff. Every good and perfect gift comes from God. If the Lord delights in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land which flows with milk and honey. Only do not rebel against the Lord and do not fear the people of the land. So those are two things that can rob you of God's blessings and the exceeding good things he has for you. Rebelling against God, disobeying him, and fearing the people, the devil, the evil, the sickness, the disease, being intimidated by it, being overawed by it, cowing down to it, giving in to it, and backing off, being inspired by fear instead of by faith. It says, for they will be our prey. Their protection has been removed from them, and the Lord is not with us. Do not fear them. So, in other words, they're not in covenant with God. So, you know, it doesn't matter how big and bad they look and how big and bad they are. God's not their protector. He's your protector. You're in covenant with God, not them. Amen. The hand of protection is not on them. Praise God. And so we don't have to fear. Greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. If God be for us, who can be against us? Amen. So they said, do not fear them. But all the congregation said to stone Joshua and Caleb with stones. So again, they're more impressed with the people in the land of Canaan than they are with God and his word. But the glory and brilliance of the Lord appeared at the tent of meeting tabernacle before all the sons of Israel. The Lord said to Moses, how long will these people treat me disrespectfully and reject me? And how long will they not believe in me despite all the miraculous signs which I have performed among them? So, you know, God has done great and wonderful things for all of us. First of all, he saved us. We're born again. We're going to heaven. We have his peace. We have his joy. We have his blessings. He's done many miracles. We could all stand up here and give testimonies all day long of the great things that he has done for us. And we got to remember that if he did it once, he'll do it again. Just like David said, he killed the lion and the bear. So guess what? This big Goliath, this big giant, he'll take care of him too. Amen. Praise God. He didn't say, well, he killed the lion and the bear, but, you know, I don't want to bother God too much. I mean, some people actually have that kind of mentality. You know, I don't want to, God help me here, but, you know, I don't want to. You know, God has other people in the world he needs, you know, that's more important than me, and he's got other things to do. I'm not going to bother God with this glad. No, if God did it once, if he did it twice, he'll do it three times, four times, five times. He'll do it every time. We win every time, praise God. Amen. I like Merton Hickey says, we don't play nine-inning games, but we play until we win, because we do win if we keep standing on God's word. Through faith and patience, we inherit the promises. Hallelujah. So, verse 12, he says, I will strike them with the pestilence, the plague, and dispossess them, and will make you into a nation greater and mightier than they. And so it's a pretty serious thing when you disobey God, rebel against God, and walk in that fear. Turn with me to 1 Kings 19. I'm going to switch to my first base glove here. That was my catcher's glove. So put this glove over here. This is for the King James only people. 1 Kings 19. So they'll know I'm saved. Praise God. But Elijah, he was Israel's most powerful prophet. He had just killed 400 prophets of Baal. He was fearless in dealing with the prophets of Baal. But then in one sentence, in one message, all of that changed. Start in verse 1 of 1 Kings 19. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and withal how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah, saying, so let the gods do to me and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. And one thing I was thinking is, you know, one thing that the Baptists, the Catholics, the Charismatics, the Methodists, we all believe on one thing, and that's Jezebel was bad. Amen. That's one thing we can agree on, I think. I don't think you'll get any argument on that one. But anyway, verse 3, it says, and when he saw that, now think about it, he really didn't see that. How did he see it? He saw it in his heart, in his mind. And that's what the devil does. You hear something, and then you see it. He tries to get you to hear something, to see something, and then to see yourself beat up by someone you're going to witness to. See yourself dead by some kind of disease. See yourself, you know, with lack and losing and just failing. That's what the devil does. He tries to get you to see it on the inside. And that's what he did to the greatest prophet in Israel. We're in good company because we've all done this kind of thing. So we're in good company. So the greatest prophet in Israel, he saw it, he heard it. And then verse 4, but he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat under a juniper tree, and he requested for himself that he might die. Man, he went from one extreme to the other. He went from, I mean, total victory to the cellar. You know, I mean, just unbelievable. So he sat by a juniper tree. He was obviously depressed. You know, he went to sleep. He said, it is enough now, Lord. Take away my life, for I'm not better than my father's. And as he lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold, an angel touched him and said unto him, arise and eat. So what he did was he gave up his place of authority by giving in to that intimidation of Jezebel, and he didn't live much longer after that. God used him a little bit more after that, but not much. He passed it on, his mantle on to Elisha, and he lost his place of authority, and that was, you know, pretty much it for him. And thank God we live in New Testament times where we got the blood of Jesus, and so we get to push that reset button over and over and over and over and over and over again. Amen. 70 times 7 and way beyond that. We can push that reset button. I messed up here, but the blood of Jesus covers that. I'm going to do better next time. Amen. I'm not going to give in to that intimidation next time. I'm not going to cow down. I'm not going to be inspired by fear. I'm going to be inspired by faith. I'm just going to keep building my faith up and listen to Pastor Sandy preach, and my faith keeps growing and growing and growing. Amen. But turn with me to Nehemiah chapter 4. Nehemiah chapter 4. You know, last year in 2012, we were at the Olympics Ministry in London, near the Olympic Eye, near the Parliament Building, near Big Ben. The marathon race was going on around Big Ben, the Parliament Building. And then we went to the Olympic Eye and passed out tracts of Jews for Jesus. And they kicked us out of the Olympic Eye. The authorities came over, and they eventually kicked us out. And we even passed out tracts on that bridge where they had that terrorist attack recently, or the bridges along there. I'm not sure if it's the exact bridge, but the bridges along there. And I remember this British man came along and he said, if you guys were Muslims, he said, they wouldn't touch you. And I got to thinking, you know, after that terrorist attack, I got to thinking, you know, that they kicked us out, kicked the light out. Mm-hmm. And when you kick the light out, guess what comes? You know, darkness. Amen. I mean, I even believe that's kind of what happened in Topeka, Kansas. What, 1900, 1901, where the outpouring of the Holy Spirit came. You know, the Holy Spirit chose Topeka, Kansas to fall, and that's where they started speaking in tongues at Charles Parham Bible School. But, you know, the legend goes that the people in Topeka rejected, so they went to Houston and then Azusa Street, and then gobs of religious churches moved into Topeka and mental hospitals, and it became a bad spirit over that city for a long time. You know, because of that. And that's why it's so important, amen, that we bring the light wherever we go, bring the gospel wherever we go, because if if we don't bring the gospel, then darkness is going to come in, because darkness is not the problem. The problem is absence of light. Amen. Because light's greater than darkness. You turn the light on in a dark room, the darkness flees, the light comes. Amen. Praise God. But in Nehemiah chapter 4, starting in verse 1, but when Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall, he became furious, completely enraged, and ridiculed the Jews. And so when the devil hears about what's going on here at Faith Community Church, you're building this church up. Praise God. And Pastor Sandy's doing such a great job. And my wife and I say all the time, you know, that what a great choice she was, you know. And, you know, Pastor Fred was a great pastor now. He got a great replacement, praise God. And guess what, though? The devil's furious. He's enraged. He's ridiculing. He's doing everything he can. He puts up a fight, amen. Like, never does he just lay down and just let you go and win souls. And, you know, there's always adversaries. There's always spiritual warfare. But the good news is, greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. We have authority over the devil every time. Amen. And if we don't quit, we win. Amen. If we don't give up, we win. If we keep standing on the word, we win. So it says in verse 2, it says, he spoke before his brothers in the army of Samaria. What are these feeble Jews doing? Can they restore it for themselves? Can they offer sacrifices? Can they finish in a day? Can they revive the stones from the heaps of dust and rubbish, even the ones that have been burned? So the devil's always saying, you can't really do this, you can't do that. Ever since the, you know, beginning in the Garden of Eden, he's, you know, did God really say that you're healed? Did God really say he's going to meet your needs? Did God really mean what he said in his word? Can they really do these things? Verse 3, now Tobiah the Ammonite was beside him and said, even what they are building, if a fox should get up on it, he would break down their stone wall. So just mocking and scoffing and ridicule. And Nehemiah prayed, he said, hear, O our God, how we are despised, and return their taunts on their own heads. Give them up as prey in a land of captivity. Do not forgive their wrongdoing, and do not let their sin be wiped out before you, for they have offended the builders and provoked you. So we built the wall, and the entire wall was joined together to its half its height, for the people had a heart to work. But when Sanballat, Tobiah, Arabs, and the Ammonites, and the Ashdodites heard that the repair of the walls of Jerusalem went on and that the breaches were being closed, they were very angry. Sounds like the 6 o'clock news there. But anyway, they all conspired together to come and to fight against Jerusalem and to cause a disturbance in it. But we prayed to our God, and because of them, we set up a guard against them day and night. Then the leaders of Judah said, the strength of the burden bearers is failing, and there is much rubble. We ourselves are unable to rebuild the wall. Our enemy said, they will not know or see us until we are among them, kill them, and put a stop to the work. And that's exactly right there, the bottom line, what the devil wants to do. He wants to stop what God wants to do through you. God has a plan, a purpose, a blueprint for your life before the foundation of the world. And that's where you're going to be the most prosperous, the most blessed, the most successful, the most fruitful. But the devil's going to try to stop that work through intimidation, through fear, just like here. This was all intimidation. This was all fear, mocking, ridicule, trying to get him to cow down, trying to get him to be inspired by fear, trying to feel that sense of inferiority that they're losers, and they're going to lose, and they're not going to be successful in building this wall. Nothing's new under the sun. You know, the devil's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen. But he's going to be in the lake of fire forever too. Praise God. But they, where did I leave off at? Which verse? Okay, verse 11. Okay, then verse 12. When the Jews who lived near them came, they said to us 10 times repeatedly, from every place you turn, they will come up against us. They said that 10 times. So verse 13, so I stationed armed men behind the wall in the lowest places at the open position where it was the least protected, and stationed the people and families with their swords, spears, and bows. When I saw their fear, you know, you can see fear on people's faces. I lead teams out on the streets and so on, and we have groups come in, you know, youth groups come in and so on, and church groups from all over the nation. There's been times where I'm, you know, giving them a pep talk on, we're going to go out there and do this and that, and here's how you do it, and so on. In fact, one night I made the big mistake of wearing this hat in North St. Louis, and had this hat on, and we had these white vans, and so I I get out of the white van with all our food and stuff and tracts and Bibles, you know. And there's these inner city kids on bikes and out here, you know. And they see me get out of this white van, and the police drive a white van. And they see me get out of a white van with this FBI hat. And they take off running. And I mean, they take off going. And I'm sitting there. I'm going, hey, come back, guys. We got food, you know. We got some drinks. We got food. And they didn't even look back. I mean, they didn't even look back. they didn't believe this white guy here. They. But anyway, when I'm giving instructions, you know, like, I can say, oops, I shouldn't have said that. I can see the fear on their faces, you know, like, oh, I shouldn't have, you know, shouldn't have told them that story, you know, I should have, you know, trying to encourage them, but it kind of worked the opposite way. In fact, one time I was in Red Valley, Arizona, ministering in Red Valley, Arizona, and I was talking about our authority in Christ and authority over the medicine man and all that witchcraft out there. And in Red Valley, they didn't have any electricity, and it was pitch dark. We were in this church and just pitch dark outside. I think we had lanterns or something inside the building, and they had a lot of Navajos don't have running water, electricity, and so on, so they had no electricity. So it's pitch dark outside. You know, Red Valley's middle of nowhere, and beautiful place, but in the middle of nowhere. So I'm preaching our authority in Christ, and we have authority over that witchcraft. Well, you know, it's so rooted in them, ingrained in them, to fear that it's going to take more than one teaching. I found that out. They would not even go outside that building afterwards because they were scared, because it was dark out there. And they needed some more renewing of the mind that, you know, they have greater is he that's in them than he that's in the world. They were, in other words, they were overawed, still overawed by the witchcraft, inspired by the witchcraft, and not by the word of God and what the word of God said. Amen. But it goes on to say here, so I stationed armed men behind the wall in the lowest places at the open positions where it was least protected. And I stationed the people and the families with their sword, spears, and bows. And when I saw their fear, I stood and said to the nobles and officials and the rest of the people, do not be afraid of them. Don't be intimidated by them. Don't cow down to their taunts and to their ridicule and to their threats. Don't be afraid of them. I've had guys, gangsters, say, you don't come to North St. Louis and tell us about this stuff. And I just keep on preaching, keep on going. Amen. Praise God. I mean, and again, that's a rare thing. Most of the time they're receptive. Just once in a while you get, a threat like that or a taunt like that. And that's just all part of the par for the course or part of the game. Amen. But he said, do not be afraid of them. Confidently, and this is amplified, confidently remember the Lord who is great and awesome. So we got to remember that. Don't be afraid of them, but confidently remember God's word, his promises. It always works. God always has your back. He always protects you, leads you, guides you, meets your needs, gives you favor, promotion, open doors. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome. And with courage from him, fight for your brothers, your sons, your daughters, your wives, and for your homes. Now, when our enemies heard that, we knew about their plot against us and that God had frustrated their plan. And that's what God will do. He'll frustrate the plan of the enemy. Amen. We all return to the wall, each one to his work. Amen. So again, we win if we don't give up. And I'm just going to close with just reading some authority scriptures. Jesus said in Matthew 28:18, in the New Amplified, he said, Jesus came up and said to them, all authority, all power of absolute rule in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Verse 19, go therefore. So he got that authority. Now he's given it to us. And now he's saying, go. Amen. Mark 16:17. These signs will accompany those who have believed in my name, will cast out demons, will speak with new tongues. If we pick up serpents and drink any deadly thing, it won't hurt us. We'll lay hands on the sick, and they will get well. Verse 20, they went out and preached everywhere while the Lord worked with them, confirming the word with signs that followed. So God will always confirm his word, so we got to preach the word first, and then God will confirm the word. Amen. And that's why it's important to speak God's word. If you speak the devil's words in fear, the devil will confirm his word, but God will confirm his word when you speak his word. Luke 10:19, New Amplified, it says, listen carefully. I have given you authority that you now possess to tread on serpents and scorpions and the ability to exercise authority over all the power of the enemy, Satan, and nothing will in any way harm you. Philippians 1:27-28, only be sure to lead your lives in a manner that will be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I do come and see you or remain absent, I will hear about you that you are standing firm. The Bible over and over again says, stand firm, hold fast, stand firm, hold fast. Standing firm in one spirit and one purpose with one mind, striving side by side as if in combat for the faith of the gospel. And then verse 28, this is very good here. And in no way be alarmed or intimidated in anything by your opponents, for such constancy and fearlessness on your part is a clear sign, a proof, and a seal for them of their impending destruction, but a clear sign for you of deliverance and salvation, and that too from God. Amen. Whew. If I had more time, I'd preach on that, but I don't have time. So Genesis 1:28, and God, this is an amplified, God blessed them, granted them certain authority, and said to them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subject it, putting it under your power, subjugate it, putting it under your power, and rule over, dominate the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and every living thing that moves upon the earth. And then finally, Philippians 2:9 through 11. Wherefore God also has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. It's above cancer, sickness, disease, heart attacks, heart disease, every name. It's a name above every name, every devil. Verse 10. That at the name of Jesus, and every knee should bow, things in heaven, things in the earth, and things under the earth. And a lot of times we quote this and say, well, when we all get to heaven, you know, every knee's going to bow to the name of Jesus. But this is talking about here on this earth. Now, at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in the earth and things under the earth. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Praise God. Hallelujah. So God has given us the authority, the victory in every area of our lives. And praise God, we're to be totally inspired by that, inspired by faith, inspired by His Word, and never to be intimidated or to cow down to anything that's evil or of the devil, any person, anything. And you know, something I found out just recently, even I was witnessing in my gym, I come up to a guy and just randomly, you know, hey, do you know Jesus? And what, I can't remember what I said. But he said, you know what? He goes, that's what I need to hear. He says, I'm just getting ready to break up with my girlfriend. I need that. He goes, I had that once, and I haven't been doing it. And now I need it because I'm getting ready to break up with my girlfriend. And he says, so thanks for telling me that. And he got my name and everything, you know. So praise God. You know, people really want to hear it. Don't be moved by the faces. Don't be moved by what it looks like or appears. You know, God looks at the heart, not at the outward. And people really are hungry. We are really living in the last days where it's a ripe harvest. Jesus said it 2,000 years ago, well, if it's ripe, then it's very, very ripe now. It's easy picking now, amen? And so, you know, these farm shows we go to minister at, we're just seeing so much receptivity to the gospel. And we were in Toronto, Canada last year in November, and they bust in kids from all over Toronto. And it's a very international city. And, I mean, these were Muslim kids and Buddhist kids, kids from the Middle East and Chinese and from all over the world coming in all week long. And we were ministering to them, and it was just so glorious and so wonderful. And, you know, a lot of them were receptive to the gospel. And it's not just in Toronto. We were at Springfield last week ministering at a farm show. And the Missouri State University students came, and a lot of international students and Muslim students came. We were able to minister the gospel to them. And so, you know, we're getting ready to go to Canada again this year, in London, England this summer. So, you know, your donations for the hats and shirts and all that goes for, you know, for those trips. So I appreciate your support, your prayers. So praise God. And I guess we need to do an altar call here. Like I said, I'm old school. And that's not old school, right? But let's have every head bowed, every eye closed, and no one looking around. If there's anyone here that doesn't know Jesus, if you're not sure if you're to die, if you'd go to heaven, I want to pray for you. Just raise your hand, and I want to pray for you to receive Jesus. Don't want anyone leaving here without knowing Jesus. I see that hand. Anybody else? Anybody else at all? Praise God. Hallelujah. Well, let's just all pray this together. Hallelujah. Just say this out loud and just know that Jesus has never rejected anybody. He's not going to reject you, because when he was hanging on that cross, he had each and every one of you on his mind. So just say this out loud. Say, Lord Jesus,
Lord Jesus,
I surrender my life to you.
I surrender my life to you.
Come into my life, Jesus.
And save me.
And change me.
Wash away my sins.
With your precious blood. And be my Lord.
And be my
Savior.
And be my whole life.
Live your life through me. And Heavenly Father, fill me with your Holy Spirit and help me to obey you all the days of my life. And I thank you, Jesus, for giving me eternal life in heaven. Amen. 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 Praise God. Well, I'll turn it over to Pastor Sandy.
Well, if you'll stand with me, please, and let's pray. Father, we thank you and we praise you for this time together. We thank you for your word. Lord God, we thank you that in you we do not have a spirit of fear. Lord, I just declare a blessing over everyone. And Lord God, we give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. Praise God.